And welcome to Bloomberg Quint. With me is Mr. Lalit Jalan, CEO of Reliance Infrastructure. Mr. Jalan, thank you for joining us on Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you for having me.
To begin with, you completed your big transaction with respect to the Mumbai distribution business, power distribution business. Now the debt is going to come down to 7,500 crores from 22,000 crores. In the next 2 years, how is the debt profile going to change and what is the kind of cash flow situation that will emerge?
Good question. If you see the strategic transformation that we took 3 years back, what were the drivers for that strategic transformation? That was to be an asset-light company, that was to be a debt-free company, that was to be a high-growth company, and that was to be a high-ROE company. I think with the culmination of this deal yesterday, we have come a long way in approaching our objective. So from a total debt and liabilities of 22,000 crores plus, we are down to 7,500 crores, which in a single transaction is a reduction of more than 65%. The interest also from 2,600 crores will come down to 800 crores. So it's a dramatic transformation for the company. If you look at the 7,500 crores of debt which is left, we have a cash flow stuck in arbitration, which is for all infrastructure power companies and regulatory assets. So if I look at my portfolio, I have 6,000 crores worth of arbitrations which I've already won.
Okay.
These are for Delhi Metro, these are for NHAI roads, and these are for Goa Power, chief among them being Delhi Metro. These means that we have won through the arbitration discussions and the arbitration panel. We have won through the single bench high court challenge by the clients there. And they are now at the final stages at the division bench. We expect announcements on these very, very soon. Some cash flows, the courts have already forced them to pay us. But there's 6,000 crores of money yet to come.
Okay.
So this is one big chunk of cash flow that will come. The second part is, if you see our transaction value for Mumbai Power is at 18,800 crores. In the first tranche, we got 13,800 paid yesterday. So the 5,000 crores amounts to previous regulatory assets up to closing, which will flow to Reliance Infrastructure as part of the deal. That's what makes it to 18,800 crores. So this 5,000 crores are for issues for which the regulator has already given a favorable opinion in other cases. We expect that judgment on these will be awarded soon. They are already, many of them have already been heard and judgment is reserved.
Normally regulatory assets work over a period of time, right? You get the money over a period of 5 to 7 years. So are you looking at discounting the entire amount and then using the cash immediately?
So both ways. I mean, we can discount the cash flows because that then can be converted into a bond kind of a structure, which is very, very strong AA plus rating, which we had done in the past also, and then pay off all the debt. Then that gets paid off from the cash flows that they get. So it's a very, very strong NCD structure. Also, as part of the deal, we can have Adani discount it and pay to us. So either way, we have both the options available. And while you're right that the cash flows might happen over a couple of years, but you can get the money upfront through discounting through a debt structure.
So in the from an operational point of view, what is the, how is the cash flow going to change for you? You have Mumbai Mumbai Power, which has gone off. Now you have core assets which have good EBITDA and all. So if you can give us a color of how the EBITDA will be looking or cash free cash flows which will be generated every year.
If you look at our Mumbai business, Mumbai business was giving a turnover of 7,500 crores out of a total turnover of 28,000 crores. So it was about 25% of our revenue. Now this 7,500 crores clearly in one full year of operation goes away. Okay. Together with it, the EBITDA of 1,500-1,600 crores also goes away and whatever you get. So let's look at the turnover first.
And there's an interest cost of 1,600 crores.
That's right. That's right. So you have the turnover, 7,500 crores. Last year, my ENC turnover was just 1,300 crores. We expect this ENC turnover to grow by to almost 7,000-8,000 crores in 2 years' time, given a portfolio of 26,000 crores.
And that's a huge jump in order book which you had in the last
already
2 years.
Have. So book to build of four, which, you know, you'll come to 7,000-8,000 crores of turnover soon. And the projects are all started. So that will fill in the entire 7,500 crores. My rest of my portfolio, which is my Delhi Power, which is my roads, which is my metro, which is my power business, which is my defense business, ENC business, these are anyway growing, right? So on turnover, we might see a dip 1 year, but from second year onwards, we'll be higher than what we have done today. On the free cash flow, we don't see any decrease at all, even in the very first year. Because while EBITDA will go down by 1600 crores, we are having also a reduction in interest of 1600 crores. So there'll be no impact on profitability for the company as a whole.
Let me take some of your core businesses like roads. You have 11 road assets. At one point in time, you wanted to hive it off into an InvITs, which I think is not going to happen now. How do you see road assets growing for you over a period of time? And will you be going into hybrid road assets? And if not, what's preventing you from looking at those hybrids opportunity?
See, the InvIT, we looked at the InvIT route. We had very good interest for the kind of portfolio we had. But what happened for the two InvITs that happened in the space, unfortunately, they didn't list well. So if you look at the road InvIT, which is available in the market, is selling at 25-30% discount to its listing price. So the investors who invest in InvIT are the same. So their question is, if we invest in your InvIT, and if it drops, they have a huge mark-to-market loss. So InvIT as a product, at least for the time being, has been misunderstood.
But and it is normally InvIT is for the annuity income and the dividend that it pays out, right?
That's
It should not be looked at that share trading kind of stuff.
No, it is not. But people, I think it was missold. But whatever it is, we'll have to go through that 1-2 year pain for people to understand, and then it can become a possibility. Today we have a portfolio of 11 assets where we've already spent the 12,000 crores. The capex is complete. Our turnover is in the region of 1300 crores this year. We have EBITDA of 850 crores. And this portfolio is growing at 13%. And we have good 18-20 year tail left. So this portfolio itself will become very profitable because we have gone through the tough phase investing and where the initial we are running into losses. So this is a very positive which is organic growth on its own. Then on top of it, one of course is the EPC space where we have taken four road projects, but that's on the EPC space. On the HAM side, we did look at it. We were not very enthused, but looking at government's emphasis of going more and more towards HAM, we will reevaluate and see if there is any opportunities in the HAM space.
Because we saw a couple of infra companies like IRB and all now going to the market raising money because you have to pay upfront for HAM. And that's the reason I asked you, you know, are you going to look at it? Because that will need capital raising from your end as well, because you need to have good, you know, gunpowder in your hand to go and bid for those projects and get it. So
no, I think you're confusing between HAM and the TOT projects.
But you have to pay.
Projects, you got to put money up front, like what Macquarie won. So they had to pay 9,500 crores up front, which is the government's monetization.
But HAM also will require
a... HAM is like a hybrid EPC and BOT. So what happens is you, it's like an EPC project where government pays you only 40%, 60% of the cost that you paid.
The remaining
40% has to be paid by you.
So the money is required upfront for.
So 40% again, you can do 2-to-1 debt equity. So 13% equity is what you need. And then you get traffic risk is out. So you have these 15 year of cash flows, which are on annuity basis. So you, there is a benefit of not having traffic risk, but you have to put equity. Today, we are not in the mood. We are saying that let's get first debt out before we start looking at committing equity. Unless you can commit it from the cash flows of the business itself.
I know Reliance Power is not technically your subsidiary because you, you're an associate because 43% stake it is there. But you have so much of stress power assets coming on the block. Now with the Allahabad High Court decision, we don't know how many of those assets will turn up into in IBC in the next couple of weeks. Will you be looking at opportunities there?
Reliance Power leadership team is evaluating opportunities in this space. We are looking at opportunities which are value accretive from day one, and we are actively evaluating. So it's not like we are missing. See, if you look at the power portfolio, we are one of the healthiest portfolios.
Exactly, 50% EBITDA margins.
We have if you see 6,000 megawatts of operating assets, 10,000 crore turnover, 5,000 crore EBITDA. We have no issues of fuel. We have no issues of PPA. We have no issues of offtake. We have no issues of getting payments for our supplies. So we are a rare company. None of our projects are stressed and none of our projects are in any restructuring or anything. So we are looking at these opportunities in this space.
Do you think that the government should look at, re-look at the coal linkage policy? Because currently it's not been allowed to use for any other power projects. And something which you've been asking the government as well for many years, saying that, okay, so even if the stressed power plants come on the block, if they don't have coal linkages and existing coal cannot be used for them, it's, we are still in a logjam, right?
No, no, if you really see, many of these projects went into this
because of this
stress was because of government issues. So you have either PPA is not there, or coal is not there, or the ROW issues, or transmission is not there. You have multiple issues, or you're not getting payments. Now, these don't go away with the change of promoter. So if you don't have a PPA, if you get a new promoter, doesn't mean that new promoter will have a PPA. But the new promoter, the benefit is, owing to this law, he's being able to buy the asset at few cents to the dollar.
Yeah.
So because he can buy at low, he's got the ability now to wait for a couple of years for the market to turn around, for the new PPAs to come in, because the power market is growing. It's not like the power market is dead. India is a growing market. Industrialization is happening, commercialization is happening, people are spending more money on consumption. There is power for all. 4 crore new customers are being connected. These customers will buy power. So there will be growth. The short-term rates will go up. States will go into buying PPA. Eventually, the finances of the states will have to improve in terms of the power companies. There are, of course, the unique cases like Gujarat and all that, which have been profitable for the last 7-8 years.
Yeah.
And they are excellent across all things, you know, from kind of tariff setting they do to the kind of profitability. Even their state electricity company earns very substantial profit.
But you know, Gujarat also has the highest, means two power projects based on imported coal stuck.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. I mean, they had the issue of the Indonesian coal law change.
Yeah.
But fine, those will get resolved. But none of them, at least, they are all paying their dues on time.
You know, I as an industry expert, I want your views on, you know, when we started this entire IBC process, we thought that there will be huge haircuts. So we had two steel companies which were going, which went through the process, and the haircuts haven't been so steep as we expected. In the power sector, when these power plants come into the market, do you see steep haircuts there because of the issues which you mentioned already?
My personal perception is that the steel was the best sector because it's a sector in very strong hands and few players, and the steel cycle is totally turned. These companies went into stress when, you know, steel prices were $250.
Yeah.
Now steel prices are very, very healthy.
Yeah.
So at these prices, these assets make a lot of sense. So, and plus they're being able to buy the assets at cheaper price.
Cheaper price.
So these assets will see less haircut. There are talks that SR Steel might not see a haircut. So those will happen. But when you come to power sector, whether it goes to IBC, there'll be much more haircut. If it is done outside of IBC, there'll be less haircut, but there'll be substantial haircut.
But you see things happening outside the IBC?
My understanding is that banks are very, very keen to solve as many of them outside IBC over the next 10-15 days.